The next item of business is Stage 3 proceedings on the Charities Regulation Administration Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is SP Bill 20A, the marshalled list and the groupings of amendments. The division bill will sound and proceedings will be suspended for around 5 minutes for the first division of the Stage 3. The period of voting for the first division will be 45 seconds. Thereafter, I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons or enter RTS in the chat function if they're joining us online as soon as possible after I call the group. Members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments. We start with Group 1, Minor and Technical. I call Amendment 4 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 5 and 9. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 4 and speak to all the amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And these are very minor amendments. Amendments 4 and 5 are self-explanatory and simply correct the language used in two places in the bill. Amendment 9 addresses a consequential amendment following on from Stage 2. At Stage 2, acting on a suggestion from the Law Society of Scotland, we removed the requirement for charities to give 42 days' notice of certain proposed changes. All that will be required now is for charities to obtain consent before going ahead with those changes. As a result, we no longer need to make provision in paragraph 4 of the Bill's schedules about how the 42-day period is to be calculated in a case where the charity ends up agreeing a different name with Oscar from the name they originally sought to consent to. And I move Amendment 4.
Thank you. I call Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Deputy Officer, we on this side welcome all the amendments in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. And just for clarity, we will be supporting them all as we go on this afternoon and will not be speaking to them.
Thank you. I invite the Cabinet Secretary if there's anything else she wishes to invite by way of wind-up. No, the question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 4. Cabinet Secretary to move or not move?
Moved.
Question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. We move on to Group 2, Register of Persons Holding a Controlled Interest in Land. I call Amendment 3 in the name of Jeremy Balfour in a group of its own. Jeremy Balfour to move and speak to Amendment 3.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I suspect this is the only slightly controversial part of this afternoon that is going to take place. But I do think it is a really important issue that we are going to debate over the next few moments. And I do hope that the Chamber will take serious the concerns raised by churches and faith groups across Scotland. What we are seeking to do is to exempt Christian charities, churches, religious bodies from a previous piece of legislation passed within this Parliament. Of course, there is already precedent for that in that Scottish charitable incorporated organisations were excluded from this. And the reason that we're seeking to do this is not because the churches and religious bodies don't want to be transparent and open, but it simply comes down to, is it reasonable and is it appropriate for them to have this? And perhaps this can be best illustrated, Deputy Presiding Officer, by a submission made by the Scottish Episcopal Church at Stage 2 of the debate that we had in committee. They pointed out, and they gave one example of why in one diocese here in Scotland. We said there were 50 congregations, 5 diocesan trustees, comprising 50 church buildings, 40 rectories, 25 church halls, which equals 100 properties in total. With each congregation having a minimum of 3 associates, the number of registrations required would be 5 times 115 times 3, which I'm sure you know, Deputy Presiding Officer, equals 1,725. If you multiply that across the 7 dioceses, we are looking at a large number of transactions that have to take place. This has to happen every time somebody is reappointed. Every time someone steps down and another person is reappointed in their place. That will mean that a lawyer will have to be instructed to do that, and that will cost money. We were told in the stage one debate that it would cost over £100,000 per year for the Church of Scotland. That is money that could be used to fund social work, to fund good causes, to fund other activities of that denomination and of churches. Every trustee that will be part of this is already on the register under OSCAR, so their names will be there for people to see and to know, and there is no hiddenness happening. I am deeply concerned that limited resources are going to be taken away from these organisations, not to do what they're set up to do, but simply to pay lawyers to do more legal work. And I'm also concerned that there's a liability issue here as well, that if there's an oversight by somebody not doing it, they're open to legal action against them. And part of this bill, and part of, I think, on behalf of all parties, that we want to see is we want to see more people coming forward to take up these positions. I believe that this would be a major step forward if this amendment was passed this afternoon by this chamber, and I do ask all members to consider it seriously. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. I now call Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I wish to make a brief contribution in relation to this amendment. I'm sure that won't come as a surprise to the Government, given my interest in this at Stage 1 and indeed at Stage 2. Indeed, on the issue of the controlling interest of land in relation to religious organisations and churches, these issues were raised by my colleague Rhoda Grant at the time of the SSI on the amended regulations earlier this year, and I will refer back to some of the points she raised at that point, which I don't think have been fully addressed by the Government. I think what is fundamental here is transparency, proportionality and accuracy. I think we would all want to see both a register of charity trustees, which this bill is seeking to put in place, but also a register of persons holding a controlled interest in land that is actually transparent and accurate. As I've said already, this bill firms up that register of trustees with OSCAR, making clear who is in control of a charity and who is responsible for it, and that is, of course, very welcome. But I think there's an opportunity to deal with concerns that have been raised by many churches and religious bodies in relation to the register of persons holding a controlled interest in land. And I don't actually view this amendment as making organisations exempt from the register of persons holding that controlled interest, but rather seeking to record their interest more accurately and reducing the burden to individual office bearers. The Government has, of course, exempted SCIOs, charitable incorporated organisations based in England, and charitable companies limited by guarantee, arguing that they are covered by alternative transparency regimes with OSCAR. Why then would religious charities not be covered by the new transparency regime that will list the trustees of individual charities, which we are considering in this bill? Those are the trustees whom we know will collectively make decisions on the assets of the charities in line with the democratic structures of their organisations. Indeed, at a cursory glance prior to coming to the Chamber, I was able to access the financial income and expenditure of the churches in the community where I live and some 37 pages of entries just from the Church of Scotland from across the whole country. And to further that example, using the Church of Scotland, they would contend that the regulations as they currently stand do not achieve the aim of transparency in who has the controlling interest in respect of the land that they own. They actually argue that the opposite is the case, because, as members will know, the Church of Scotland will have to record individuals who hold congregational offices, that is the minister, the session clerk and the treasurer, and they are deemed by these regulations to be the people who exercise control or have significant influence over the land. Actually, though, the governance of the Church of Scotland is designed to preclude individual control. Indeed, I'm sure we remember from our history lessons, I think that was the whole point of the Reformation. So no single individual, including those named office bearers, have control over decision-making in relation to land. So actually, the register would then be inaccurate. It actually then, we could argue, would not be wholly transparent, or indeed create that level of transparency that I think we all intended when the legislation was passed, albeit I wasn't a member of this Parliament. So would it not make far more sense for the organisation to be registered as the organisation which holds the controlling interest to better reflect that accuracy of decision-making processes and the decisions that will be taken on the land within the organisation. Given that the details of those organisations are publicly available and their trustees will, by virtue of this bill, be on the charity register. Presiding officer, I will finish where I started with my colleague Rhoda Grant, who said at the time of that SSI that the legislation was designed to close tax loopholes and to create transparency about who the beneficial owners of land are, especially when that land is held in companies that are registered in tax havens. But it should not put an unacceptable burden on Scottish churches. I think that there must be a solution that we can find that has balance in transparency, proportionality and accuracy. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just contribute briefly to the debate on this amendment in the name of Jeremy Balfour and declare my interest as a member of the Church of Scotland? And can I just echo what both Mr Balfour and Paul O'Kane have just said in relation to the importance of the amendment that's before us today? The Land Reform Scotland Act 2016 provides that there should be transparency in terms of persons having a controlling interest in property in Scotland. That's a perfectly legitimate and credible policy outcome sought by this Parliament at the time. The problem is that that legislation has unintended consequences. I don't think it was ever intended when that legislation was put forward that we would see churches and charitable organisations, religious charities, caught in the way that they have been as a result of this legislation. And we've all been approached by church groups raising their concerns about this. The Church of Scotland has a Presbyterian structure. Essentially, that means that decision-making is devolved to a local level, to local parishes and local kirk sessions who are elected by the members of the individual churches. And therefore, the titles to properties held at a local level are in names of those individual kirk sessions. And those kirk sessions change regularly. Sometimes they can change as often as annually. And there will be a continual churn and cycle of the names of people involved. And as has already been pointed out, there will be an enormous administrative burden put upon local churches of having to comply with these particular regulations in relation to persons holding a controlling interest in land. The Church of Scotland say they currently have title to 5,000 properties across Scotland. In local areas, that would be church buildings, church halls, manses, and other properties they might own. Each one of those 5,000 properties will require to be registered in the name of 3 office bearers. Every time, so that's a huge burden to start with, then every time there's a change in those office bearers, which might happen on an annual basis, they will all need to be re-registered. And again, that puts a huge burden on the Church of Scotland and indeed other churches across the country. And as members will be aware, the Church of Scotland is presently going through a reorganisation, amalgamating presbyteries, amalgamating a number of parishes, reducing the number of places of worship due to the decline in the number of worshippers and the decline in the number of ministers, and is already facing quite significant financial challenges. And to put on the Church of Scotland at this time the additional financial burden that Jeremy Balfour has referred to would seem to be entirely inappropriate. So I would say, in closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, I cannot see there is any public policy interest in pursuing the requirement that churches and other religious charities should have to comply with these particular regulations. It seems simply bureaucracy for bureaucracy's sake. And so I would support the amendment that's being put forward by Jeremy Balfour. And I would say to the government, if the government is not minded to support this amendment, I think it really needs to tell us what other mitigations it might put in place to try and address the issues that have been identified. I know it's been suggested there might be a delay in the regulations being brought forward, but all that does is postpone the inevitable. I mean that these additional burdens will still come in and will last until time immemorial, with an annual cost to churches and local kirk sessions. So if the government's not going to support it, and I hope the government will, if they're not prepared to support this amendment, please can they tell us what else they're going to do to try and solve this problem. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Willie Rennie to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I just want to make an appeal to the Cabinet Secretary. I think the arguments that have been set out this afternoon are eminently sensible. We've heard about the Church of Scotland. It's designed to preclude individual control, but the government is going to require those organisations to state who has that individual control when that individual control just does not exist. So I don't understand why the government is pursuing this when there's a perfectly practical solution to this, to avoid double registration and double reporting, to reduce the burden, to make sure we don't discourage volunteers from coming forward to operate within these organisations, and it reduce cost as well. I think Murdo Fraser's last point is also incredibly sensible. I understand the government is probably going to push ahead with its proposals, but therefore it has got an obligation to make sure that this does not cause an undue burden to these organisations, and therefore they have mitigations, proper, meaningful mitigations in place, because we cannot deal with the consequences when these organisations are already going through quite significant turbulence. So I hope the Minister will have a last-minute change of heart, but if not, we need mitigations in place.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And, you know, from the outset, this bill hasn't been controversial, but this section certainly has been. And certainly the churches and faith groups who really do have great concern over this have been quite clear. And I state from the briefing the Church of Scotland have put that the Church have sought to explain these points on countless times to the Scottish Government and offer constructive solutions. But, you know, they say quite clearly they've been disappointed that the Scottish Government have not recognised the willingness to work with them. And have been unable to appreciate their situation. And it's clear, as has been stated in the debate, that there are going to be unintended consequences. I think ministers accept that because they have already said that there will be a year extension to this for churches and faith groups. So as has been stated by others, I think it is important that there are mitigations in place around this, and whether or not the Cabinet Secretary will look at reviewing this before it comes into place. I don't know where the government whips and the Green and SNP whips are today, but whether or not this could be supported, as I don't think it's controversial that these regulations can be excluded from this bill at this stage. Certainly throughout stage one and two, we have made these arguments on a cross-party basis, as have church and faith groups. And I think it is important because, as Fergus Ewan stated in the debate at stage one, it is clear that these will have financial impacts. None of us in this chamber want to see more money being used by our charities for legal costs. We want it to go to their purposes and for churches doing good in our society. So I hope the Cabinet Secretary will take on board the concern cross-party on this and that mitigation and review can be brought in early, especially given the one-year extension I think she will tell Parliament about soon. Thank you.
I call the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'm afraid I cannot support Amendment 3 in the name of Jeremy Balfour for the same reasons I could not support it at Stage 2. Charity regulation is fundamentally in place to ensure and maintain public trust in the operation of charities. Register of persons holding a controlled interest in land, known as the RCI, was an essential part of the Land Reform Act unanimously passed in 2016. The purpose of the RCI is to improve transparency in relation to land and property assets, irrespective of what type of legal entity owns them, and to ensure there is a direct link between the property and whoever exercises a controlled interest in that property. This bill seeks to increase transparency in relation to charities and is not about the RCI. All parties supported the introduction of the RCI, which is a key part of our land reform strategy. Much progress has been made by this Parliament on delivering greater transparency in relation to individuals who have control over decision-making in relation to land. The RCI regulations are a complex piece of legislation, and this amendment risks unintended consequences.
Rhoda Grant.
I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary agrees with me that those provisions were put in place to find who the beneficial owners were, who offshore their companies, who hide behind legislation and who don't pay their taxes. At no point did anyone think churches would be caught up in that legislation. And I'd appeal to her to look at this again, because what is happening with the delay in enacting that part of the legislation is that the people who seek to hide their companies offshore and avoid scrutiny in Scotland are allowed off the hook, while people who are volunteering for churches are actually being held to account in a way that was never intended.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I do appreciate the concern that's been shared today by members, but I do still believe it would be a backward step for land reform if members were to support this amendment, which would reduce transparency of ownership and control for some of the largest organisations in scope of the RCI by the number of property titles they hold. Now, just last week, the Chamber debated the need for further changes to address concentration and transparency of land ownership and to support more communities into land ownership. This amendment would cut across that need for transparency. Now, the information that will be available on the Scottish Charity Register under Section 2 of the Bill is charity trustee names. The RCI relates to transparency in ownership and control of property and as such requires additional information to simply a list of names. The two registers require different information. They are not the same and the people who own or tenant the land may not be the same people as the charity trustees. So it is not correct to say that the two registers will contain duplicate information. Nor is it required for there to be any financial cost to make a submission to the register. And it is one of the areas that the government and others are working very carefully and closely with the churches on to see what more can be done to simplify this process to ensure that some of the concerns around the need for legal representation are allayed during this process. And addressing the concerns is a very important part of that. Returning to some of the aspects that Murdo Fraser talked about, is an issue which I take very seriously, and that's why there is continuing engagement to ensure that we find the appropriate way to support stakeholders and to deal with the issues that members have raised today, but for that not to be done through a carve-out, as is being suggested in this amendment. Now, the Scottish Government has already extended the transitional period for compliance by 12 months to the 1st of April 2024, providing more time to those who need to register with the RCI, a move which gained the unanimous support of this Parliament. So while I appreciate the concerns have been raised by religious organisations about the RCI, this bill on charity regulation is not the place to change the obligations of the RCI, and I urge members not to support the amendment today.
Thank you. I call Jeremy Balfour to press a withdrawal amendment. Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank all members for the contribution of this? I should perhaps also declare that I am a member of the Church of Scotland. If I can just respond to a few points made by the Cabinet Secretary in her comments. I think the issue that perhaps the Scottish Government are missing here is in regard to control of property and who controls property. So if I can give an example, when I in a previous life was a Baptist minister, the title deed of the Church of the Manch was always held in the name of the minister, the church secretary and the treasurer. And they were the people who would sign the documentation. But in regard to the control of whether that church or that manch could be sold was down to the church meeting, was down to the local congregation to make that choice. The trustee, the owner, the people who had the name had to take, didn't have that power to take that decision. The decision was made by the church. So when we're talking about who is owning the land, it is not in regard to three individuals whose names are on a title deed. It is a local congregation or it is a denomination. And I do think that point is really important to make. I do think the cost issue is a big one. Again, the Episcopal Church, in their submission to the committee at stage two, made it clear that in their view, that this would have to be done by lawyers. And I do welcome what the Cabinet Secretary has said in her remarks today, but I do think further progress has to be made in regard to that, or we are simply lining the pockets of lawyers. I understand that there is this one-year period, and if the amendment falls this afternoon, I do hope that the government won't just engage in conversation. Conversation engagement is important, but unless it brings about some change in what is actually happening on the ground, then it's just simply talking for talking's sake and doesn't actually get us anywhere. So we do have this 12-month period. I do hope that there can be significant movement by the Scottish Government on this to make sure that, yes, there is transparency and openness, but actually that churches and religious organisations from all faiths can get on and actually do what they are about, which is helping those within the local community. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division, as this is the first division of the stage. I am going to suspend briefly for around 5 minutes to allow members to access the digital voting system.